Cameron?
Cameron.
Okay. So let's continue. So our plan for today, we will have slightly shorter than usual class today because the new trainings that are going faster than light. Actually, let me just for fun, let me start the class 5 minutes talking about those new trainings. Because it's clearly a very important agenda. Okay, so as you know, so this is just for fun. As you know, there's this opera experiment that is claimed to do the following. They produce neutrinos here, they measure neutrinos there. Okay? And then there are lots of details about how they compute when they produced, how they compute when they measured, how they compute the distance and so on. And there may well be problems and all those things that I'm going to tell us about at 4 o'clock today. But really surprising thing about it is that if you believe their results, what they did is they measure the distance, they measure the time, they compute it L by T, and they get a number that is C, speed of light, you know, 1 plus, I can't even remember, 10 to minus 5, something else. Okay. So you might wonder, you might wonder, suppose this was true. So maybe we're looking at these neutrinos, right? It's just true. Okay. So you might wonder, if this was true, do we have to throw away all of physics as we understand it? Okay, so most likely, as I think Amol will tell us today, there's an experiment. But suppose it's true. Suppose it's true. Would we have to give up physics as it is understood today? Now, you might think, well, let's think about it. Suppose special relativity was correct in flat Earth, then it would be impossible for anything to go faster than light. And the world was flat. Okay? Then it would be impossible for anything to go faster than light. Okay? So, if everything was just flat and special relativistic, I think, if this experiment is correct, we'd have to rewrite 100 years of physics. Okay. Now, you might wonder, well, what about, suppose space was curved? Suppose there's more curvature in space-time than we thought, for some reason or the other. And it's the effect of this curvature that accounts for this extra fast propagation. It's not Euclidean geometry, that's why it's so fast. And the problem with that explanation is that if that were the case, then anything, including light, would take the same amount of time to go from one spot to another because of the equivalence principle. GD6 such as GD6. So that looks very complicated. But there is another answer that just to give a throw of possibilities for answers that might be totally crazy. You know, might be correct without requiring to throw out all of physics as we understand.
Sorry.
So I'm taking this scenario from a paper that somebody wrote a couple of days ago, a guy called Stephen Kopsa, and he's based it on many other previous papers. But his idea is very simple. The idea is, suppose we live in a world with more than 4 dimensions. And there's a brain. What is a brain? It's some special surface in this 4-dimensional space. On which most of the fields of the standard model are localized. Okay? So there's space-time is, let's say, 5-dimensional. But there's a 4-dimensional brain, it's like a rubber sheet sitting there. And all the particles of the standard model, or most of the particles of the standard model, are vibrations of this rubber sheet. So, as far as these particles are concerned, you don't really see the fact that space is 5-dimensional. Okay? But suppose that the neutrino is a particle that's not localized to this brain, but propagates in the 5th dimension. Then, it could be that a neutrino going out into this 5th dimension and coming here arrives faster than something that is constrained to stay on this surface. How could this happen? Let me make it a little more precise. Suppose the metric of your space, okay, Whereas ds squared is equal to e to the power, let's say, 2a over r. So r is the fifth coordinate. So the coordinates are r and the four space-time coordinates of the vector. Suppose ds squared is e to the power 2a of r minus h of r dt squared. Okay? Plus dx x squared. Plus e to the power 2b of r. Yes. Okay. Now, suppose this was the case. Suppose this was the case. And now you ask, and suppose that at this break, so we say r equals, I don't know, 0, if it's some distinguished value for r, let's say 0 is the break. And h of r, 0, is equal to 1. So for this reason, anything that's stuck to the break moves at the speed of light. But something that's not stuck to the break, okay, could go down, propagate here, come back up. How fast would this propagation be? Well, it would have to be, suppose you're propagating just on the x direction. You're going along the local null rate here. So the equation you're obeying is h of r dt is equal to dx, or dx by dt is equal to h of r. So if the space was something like this, where h of r somewhere where r was not 0 becomes larger than 1, then something down here can propagate faster than the effective speed of light for this breakdown. So you can imagine a path that does this, comes back up here, faster than any excitation that's localized on this surface could reach the same point. Okay? Now this proposal is way out for a number of different reasons. I mean, let me just say what these reasons are. I say all this because I feel it's like 1 in 10,000 that the experiment is correct. But if it is 1 in 10,000, I mean, if that one chance is born out, then there's an opportunity for a new Einstein. So it's very important. Okay. Almost certainly it's wrong, but suppose it's correct. Okay, so, fine. So let's look at this. Now, what are the problems with this scenario? The problems with this scenario are many. As Amar will explain today, this is not the first time neutrino speeds have been measured. They've been measured in a supernova experiment, supernova that was seen on Earth in 87. Neutrinos and light came at the same time from the supernova as far as we can tell. And the distance from the supernova is so large that if this difference in speed had been what these guys say, then there should have been the neutrinos should have come before the light by years. So it's not an experimental error. Okay, the response is, well, the neutrinos that came from the supernova had much lower energy than the neutrinos that came from that were measured at Grand Sasso. So perhaps how far these neutrinos go down in the space, this is just a cartoon picture of what I'm showing. How far the neutrinos go down in the space depends on the energy. And at higher energy, things go further down. It's a bit weird. Sorry. Okay, the other equally weighty objection is that there's fabulous experimental evidence that electrons don't exceed the speed of light. You know, electrons, neutrinos are hard to measure, but electrons are bread and butter stuff. You have them zooming around in accelerators all the time, you measure their properties all the time. There's fabulous experimental evidence that electrons don't move faster than light. Now, for those of you who know some particle physics, you know that under the SU2 left Gibbs symmetry, electrons and neutrinos form doublet. And so had that gauge symmetry been an unbroken symmetry of the real world, then whatever the electron was doing, whatever the neutrino was doing, the electron would also have to be doing. So it seems inconsistent that the neutrino goes down here while the electron stays here. Okay? And the possible way out for this is electroweak symmetry is not an exact symmetry of the real world. It's broken by Higgs mechanics. And perhaps the same thing that breaks this that does the Higgs in. gives you differences of speeds between the electron and the neutron. Now, I have to say that just this little analysis we've done so far already means it's something like a conspiracy. I mean, so it's a little like, you know, it's a little like the claim that, I don't know, the U.S. intelligence agencies get 9/11. I mean, it's not impossible, but it sounds like 1 in a million, right? It sounds beginning to sound to me like that, because every other piece of data doesn't agree with this. But then you try to find some way of experimenting. Right? Okay, but who knows? Okay, so the reason I said all this is to say that, you know, suppose this experiment is correct. You see, in physics, as we understand it, there is something so sacrosanct about the local light. But there is nothing sacrosanct about global incidence. If you have a solution of general relativity, such that at infinity it is flat four-dimensional space, then you have such that it's basically an physics about flat four-dimensional space. Then you've got global incidence, things propagate at the speed of light, kind of in the six dimensions. But if you've got more complicated solutions of general relativity, the principles of general relativity certainly do not imply that the vacuum of your theories, the universe you live in, has global Lorentz invariance. Okay? This would be a situation in which it doesn't. Because if you try to make the T and X Lorentz transformation, it would have worked. It would have been a symmetry of the metric, and H could work. But it isn't. Away from R equals 0, and H is not. But it's perfectly consistent with the basic principles of general relativity. Okay? So I just thought I would say this. Then there are two possibilities. Either all of, suppose this experiment is correct, either all of physics, you know, it's the basic formalism of physics, have to be thrown out, or that the world is somehow more interesting. You know, we could possibly accommodate this within general relativity, though not with special. Okay. Fine. Okay. This was all, of course, for entertainment. Just because we're hearing so much about this experiment. And I just wanted to say how a string theorist might think about this issue, if it was correct. But most likely it's not. Okay, any questions or comments? Yes.
Oh,
my. Any idea of this? Sorry, there's a problem with the final battery. Hopefully it'll just pick up. Okay, so now that we've had our fun, let's get back to our course. Okay? The main thing I want to discuss today is the notion of energy and momentum in general. Thank you. No, the basic idea, so...
The scientific question, I think it has very stringent constraints.
Yeah, the basic idea could easily be extended to any dimension. There are many problems with the analysis. Okay? I mean, if you want to get a model that will actually work, fitting everything, you'll have a lot of problems, I think. But it makes the point that it doesn't necessarily require throwing off basic principles. Could just reflect that there is a more complicated vacuum than you previously thought. Yes. Okay. Now, let's remind ourselves of the Einstein equations. So the Einstein equations were in the compass script. Einstein equations were R I J minus R G I J R is equal to 8 by K. Is equal to 8 by K. We proved in the course of deriving these equations. The thing that we proved was that the left hand side is true as an identity that Di of R I J minus of G I J is R. So it's zero. This is not true from dynamics, it's just true for any metric configuration. It's an identity. This is something we checked in our lecture in the lecture theory. And so this equation, or you know, just by taking that, if this equation is true, then it automatically implies conservation of the stress tensor. It implies that I, T, I, J is zero. Independently, we checked that T, I, J satisfies this equation. Okay? So it was all a nice consistent story. And so it might seem that conservation of stress energy is built into the basic structure of generality. So it would be easy to find a definition for energy and momentum in general relativity. Just take the stress, let's say, integrate it, and shouldn't that be conserved by consciousness? The answer to that is no. This is no because this is not an ordinary derivative, but a covariant derivative. Okay. Now, early on in our discussions of, and this is probably in your homeworks, then, early on in our discussions of curved coordinates, we found an expression, a simplified expression, for the divergence of the symmetric lens. The really simple expressions were for the divergence of an anti-symmetric lens. Okay? Where it was just putting a square root g inside, and a 1 by square root g outside. Yeah. The expression for a symmetric lens was more complicated, and I'll remind you of that. The expression for a symmetric lens was that this is equal to 1 by square root G. Del by del x k of t k I square root minus g. This is exactly like it would have been for an anti-symmetric lens. But then there's an additional case. Minus half del g k l by del x I b k l. Okay, let's really not use l because distinguishing. Okay, so the only free index here is I. Okay. This is an identity that is true for any symmetric lens. Now, if you took, suppose we had an identity that didn't have this term, then if you take square root minus g of this divergence and integrate it, you know, if we take this equation, suppose this term was not there, then we take this equation, multiply by square root minus g and integrate over all space. That's this equation. The square root minus g will cancel the square root minus g. Okay? And we will get the integral over total derivative. And so we will then be able to associate a conserved energy momentum tensor associated with the space, with the integral over space time slice of tk normal to the space time, normal to the slice that we integrate. Okay? But this term is. So this term spoils this formal conservation of the stress tensor, leading to a conserved quantity. It spoils us from concluding that we have conserved energy momentum from Gauss. Okay? And it's just not true that the integral of the stress tensor, the matter stress tensor, dotted with the normal, is a conserved quantity. Now, you might worry, what's going on here? Does that mean that general relativity is incompatible with conservation of energy and conservation of momentum, which are very basic, you know, principles of physics? And the answer is no. The thing is that you're just trying to incorrectly identify what your energy momentum stress tensor is. Okay? And intuitively, the reason, the thing that you're doing incorrectly is trying to associate all the energy momentum in your system with the matter. Now, in general relativity, you could have gravitational waves, for instance. Gravitational waves are no matter, but they carry energy. Okay. So the thing that's going to be conserved is the energy of the matter, free spinning, plus the energy of the gravitational field. So it would have been strange, actually, had we been able to get a conservation law just from the matter. Okay? But now, the question that we're going to ask is how do we find what is the correct expression? How do we find the correct expression for the conserved energy momentum dead subspace? Okay, is the question. Okay, now, the way we're going to work this out, okay, for the Black-Hall issues, is very clever. The first thing we're going to do is to study this equation in a frame at one point. Okay? In a frame where the first derivative is a metric branch. Okay? In this case, this equation just boils down to tk of del ki is equal to 0. If we are in a coordinate system at a point in which all first derivatives is a metric branch. Because you can take the square root g out, so that would be deferred from this thing by first derivative of the metric, and this term is 0 because of the first derivative. Okay, now we've commented that in such a frame, the conservation of the stress tensor would re express, well, we've commented that the conservation of the stress tensor would re express through the Einstein equations. Becomes an identity, it doesn't use equations of motion. So, in such a frame, in a frame in which the derivatives of g vanish at a given point, this equation, plus use of the Einstein equations, should just be an identity. Okay? Let me say this again. In an arbitrary frame, this equation is an identity. Okay? But in a frame in which first derivatives of the metric vanish. This equation should be an identity. It should be true that del I, okay, to the upper lower left hand, they want t with both upper. So del I of r I k minus half g I k r. So it must be true that in a frame in which first derivatives of the metric vanish at that point, this equation is true. Okay? Now let's check that directly. If it's true, we should be able to say it directly, and we're going to try to determine it directly. Now, before we even do any calculations, we could ask, how could such an equation be true as an identity? And that is a very simple way. Suppose this quantity, Rik minus half Gik half, okay, was equal to lambda Ikm del by del x. Well, lambda is some expression. Such that lambda is symmetric in Imk. Okay? And lambda is antisymmetric in K. Okay? Suppose we could find an expression of this form. Then, let me take the kth derivative of this. That would give me 0 because I would have del k, del m, and lambda km give you vanishing ways of the antisymmetry. Remember, we're dealing with ordinary derivatives rather than covariant derivatives because we're working at a point where first derivatives are metric as in. Okay? So, this is a way in which it could work and turns out to be the way in which it does work. Okay? So, our goal, our algebraic goal for the next 10 minutes. Is to find an expression to show this and to find an explicit expression for this lambda IK. Is this clear? Any questions or comments? Okay? But let me tell you where we are going even before we do it. What, say again?
Why
do you require these? Yeah. Well, this has to be symmetric between I and K because both these expressions are symmetric, okay? Well, at least the derivative has to be symmetric between them, okay? Actually, that's the more accurate statement, that this derivative is symmetric between I and K, not necessarily lambda. Okay? Well, it's important that lambda itself is antisymmetric between K and M, because then conservation of the stress tensor will become an identity, because del by del x k, del by del x m, lambda I k m would be identity zero. Because of the antisymmetric. Okay? Yeah. So we don't require that lambda itself is antisymmetric, symmetric between I and K. We require that the derivative of lambda is. Okay? But we do require that lambda itself is symmetric between K and I. Okay? And that's how it's going to work. Though unfortunately it's going to be a little algebra to see that. So we have to roll up our sleeves and do the algebra. Okay, but before we start doing the algebra, let me show you, let me tell you where we're going. Okay. Once this is true, we're going to get an expression such that what we're going to do is the following. What we're going to do is to identify the stress energy tensor, the true stress energy tensor of space-time, the thing we have to integrate if we want to find the energy momentum. With this expression, whether or not we're working in a frame in which the first derivative is of G dash. See how clever this is. This is really clever. Because this expression, you have to see the expressions to reference to really make sense. We can derive them. But you know, this lambda is going to be built out of some derivatives of the lambda is going to be built out of some expression involving the metric tensors. Okay, some second derivatives of metric tensors. Okay. Now that expression, whatever it is, is manifestly considered. Okay? Maybe I should make this point after we've done that. Maybe it'll be clear after. Let's first start where we're getting. Okay. I'm going to write down where we are heading towards, what we want to show, and then we will try to do the painful algebra that establishes. Okay. do we want to show? We want, what I'm going to demonstrate to you is the following. Let me not call this lambda, let me call it zeta. Okay, I'll follow lambda notation. He calls it eta. It's a very obvious little thing to use because it reminds you of the metric of flat space. But anyway, that's what he calls it. Okay, now, what we're going to show is the following. We're going to show that this expression we're going to find the following. Suppose we define h I k n is equal to del by del x n lambda I k l. Lambda I K L M is equal to, and he's putting some factors for 16 K L. So that will agree after using the understanding bridge. Normalization is going to suggest what's that. G I K G L F. Minus G I L G K. Yes, we forget about that. Okay. Then in our special frame, with this definition of lambda, and in terms of lambda, this definition for H, we're going to show that del by del x a, h I k a, is equal to minus g d I k. Okay, so this h is almost a theta, except that there's a factor of g between them. The G doesn't matter, that in the special frame. Okay, this is what we're going to try and show actually. Now before I go through the algebra, which will take us some time, painful, let me assume that we've completed this algebraic exercise. Okay? And let me draw the consequences from it. Because that's the important thing. The algebra we have to do because we teach in the class, but that's the point. See? Let's first extract the consequences. Okay. Now, look. Firstly, let's look at this. Firstly, we want to show that, we want to check that all these equations are consistent. So the first thing I want to check is that this thing defines something that is symmetric. Yeah, okay. It just couldn't be true that this equation was correct unless the left hand side was symmetric. So let's check that. So what we have is del by del xa of hika, so del by del xa of hika and h I k m, so that's del by del x m of ignoring this factor for a moment. This factor symmetric minus g I k g l m minus g I l g k m. Oh my, sorry. I needed it. H I K L. So L should be A. Okay. So I want to check whether this thing is symmetric between when this one is symmetric in. Whether this quantity is symmetric in I and K. Okay. Okay, so let's see. The point is, this is obvious. Because A and M are dummy variables. Okay? So this term is obviously symmetric, and this term is also obviously symmetric. Not that the symmetry wasn't true until we've taken the A variable. So it was not true that H was symmetric between I and K. This is a general thing. Those of you who have studied the permutation group know it's difficult to both make things symmetric in some indices and anti-symmetric in other indices unless the indices are disjoint. If you start symmetrizing one set of indices and then after that anti-symmetrize another set of indices, it ruins the symmetrization of the first set. Okay? So it would not be possible to find an H that itself is symmetric. Okay? But the derivative isn't the one that's needed. Okay, so this is the first part. The second point is that we want to show that this quantity is manifestly conservative. Okay? So, what we want to do is choose one of these variables, let's say del by del xi. Okay? We want to take del by del xi of this and see that it's 0. But all that that requires is checking that we have anti-symmetry between I and, let's say, A. That this H here, that the H itself was anti-symmetric between I and A. So let me write down the H. So from here we have del by del xm of numbers which I'm ignoring minus g h I k l g I k g l m minus g I l g k l. And I want to show that it's anti-symmetric between one of these, this index and one of these indices. Let's see. K. Suppose I change K and L. If I change K and L. Yeah, that's clear, right? You see, suppose I change K and L. Let me just do the interchange. HI of LK. Okay, HI of LK is equal to del by del XM of minus G. GI. Where I have K, I should put L. Where I have L, I should put K. G, K, M. Minus G, I, K, G, L, M. And this term is the same as this term. This term is the same as this term. The relative minus sign is the absolute. Okay? So, suppose I manage to show you the algebra that leads to this thing, and that's a big supposition, we have to get the algebra right. Suppose I manage to show you this algebra, then we have established that, quite in general, there is, what have we established? We've established that there is a quantity, H, okay, such that d by dxa of hika gives you a quote-unquote stress tensor that's automatically conserved. Moreover, this quantity reduces to the matter stress tensor in a frame in which first derivatives of metric vanish. Now, you know, a frame in which first derivatives of metric vanish, we're in the locally falling element, Okay. We can't distinguish that frame from just flat space locally. So the matter stress, the full stress energy tensor of gravity should have the property that it gets no gravitational contribution in a frame in which first there is a symmetric dimension. Okay? So what we've done now is to find an expression that it has two good properties. Okay. One, that it reduces to the matter energy stress energy tensor in a frame in which, in a locally Euclidean frame. And two, that it is manifestly always conserved. It's manifestly always conserved because you take del by del xi of it, you get zero. So now you can use Gauss's law. You can now use Gauss's law to define a charge associated with this tensor. And that charge will automatically be conserved.
Will Gauss's law be to apply on the region?
Yes.
But we are considering only a point where we have made the derivative.
Okay, good. This is a very important point, and let me say it again. We have established, what have we done? We've established that this quantity is equal to the matter stress tensor only in a frame in which first there is a symmetric dimension. However, the good properties of this quantity, the fact that it defines a stress tensor that's symmetric, and the fact that it defines a stress tensor that's not covariantly but ordinarily conserved, applies in every frame. Do you see? In the check, let me say this again. What we're going to show using algebra is that in a frame in which the first derivatives of the metric vanish, the matter stress tensor reduces to this expression. However, now that we've got the expression, forget about where it came from. Okay? The fact that I'm going to define a stress tensor, what Landau-Lipschitz called stress energy pseudo tensor. Okay? I'm going to define a stress tensor by this formula.
So, if you originate this formula, we just show that their derivative will be zero at that point.
Yes. So, let me say it. This is true with the matter stress tensor if the derivative is zero at that point. Okay? Now I'm going to define del by V, del x a h I k a is equal to minus g t full. Okay? I k. In every frame. This is my definition of the full local stress energy pseudo tensor. I say pseudo because it's clearly not a tensor, because we're not defining it by covariant derivatives.
This is the definition.
This definition satisfies the good property that in a frame in which the first derivatives of the metric vanish, the definition reduces to, by Einstein's equations, it gives you the matter stress energy. But the definition is a definition, doesn't it? It's a definition for all frames. Okay? Now, for this to happen, to work, it's necessary that all the consistency properties, you know, the properties that we want of this thing, that it gives you a symmetric stress tensor, and that it's conserved, otherwise it's not interesting, work independent of using the first derivative of the metric vanish. But we just check it. In our check of these two properties, we know what I use for the first derivative of the metric vanish. Okay?
So the fact that for the matter stress energy tensor that it's been covariantly conserved.
Yes.
Is it a consequence of that this the ordinary derivative of this is zero and all frame?
That
by construction.
Well, you see, that the ordinary derivative of this is zero is just an identity.
It's just an identity.
Right? We define something. And for an arbitrary metric, the ordinary derivative of that is zero. But, you know, you can find many identities that are of the form some derivative of something is zero. Most of them will not be interesting. This one is interesting, however, because this quantity, in a frame in which the first derivative of the metric vanishes, reduces to what it should reduce to. namely the matter stress energy tensor. Okay? So this quantity deserves, at least provisionally deserves, let me see, as we go on more checks that deserve it, the name stress energy tensor, pseudo tensor of general relativity. It's the notion of, it's basically a notion, it's basically a notion, no thermodynamics, basically a notion of localized stress tensor in general relativity. Now, we should take this notion too seriously. We should take this notion too seriously because it's not a tensor. So, for instance, in one frame it can be that this thing reduces just to the matter stress tensor. So it's zero because there's no matter stress tensor. Another frame it could be that it's non-zero, just because we change coordinates. We should take this the local definition of it too seriously. However, what we're going to use is this object as a crutch to integrate, to get an integrate, and to get a global notion of energy, which, as I will argue, we will be able to take seriously.
Just
so
one last
clarification. Yes.
The fact that the ordinary derivative of this is zero is independent of your conservation of stress energy.
It's an identity for any metric field.
And it matches that conservation.
Now, it reduces to the statement by, first, this statement that it's conserved, that the thing is ordinarily conserved, works for any metric field. No mention of Einstein equations. This is just a statement about geometry. Okay? However, by use of Einstein equations, it reduces to the conservation of the matter stress energy tensor in a frame in which first derivatives of the metric match. This second statement is the thing that gives you some confidence that this quantity will be associated with the actual stress tensor of a system.
Actual stress energy tensor will be the Laplacian acting on T mu is equal to
zero. Is that right? Laplacian. The actual stress energy tensor will be
the derivative of T mu is equal to zero.
That is the actual matter stress energy tensor. Okay, the full stress energy tensor of general relativity includes matter stress energy tensor plus other stuff. Okay, the thing that physically deserves to be called the stress energy tensor, the thing by which, if you integrate, you get the conserved energy and the conserved momentum of your system, is not the matter stress energy tensor. It's because gravity also carries energy. Gravitational waves, for instance. Okay? So we're going to make a claim. We're going to make the claim that this object, T full, defined in this way, is what we are going to define as the stress energy tensor of a system. Now, as we said, stress energy tensor itself has very little. However, because, it's not coordinate invariant, even the fact that it's zero is not coordinate. Okay? However, what we're actually going to do is not worry so much about the local formula, but try to get a formula for the globally conserved energy and momentum.
Just one more. So when you're talking about conservation, you need a time direction for it. You need to say that delta n t is zero. And that choice of time, you're saying since your theory is covariant,
hang on, we're coming to that. Good, that's a good question. Okay, so suppose.
Because when is the lambda?
In showing that this quantity reduces to the matter stress tensor, we use the first derivatives of the metric match. But in showing that H is conserved and that it is symmetric, that del by del XA is symmetric, we have not used it. Okay? So, see, just as a matter of algebra, we make this definition of lambda, we make this definition of H, and we make this definition of T.
That's what I'm saying, sir. If I
take
lambda in that way, you are not using any derivative.
No, this is how we came upon this definition. But now forget where we came to it for a minute. Okay? Somehow or the other, I just tell you, I define lambda this way. Then I define H this way, and I define T full this way. Okay? You may or may not agree that it's an interesting thing to do, but you can't stop me from making these definitions. So it doesn't matter. Okay? Now, I will demonstrate to you just with these definitions that this quantity is, that this H full is symmetric between I and K. Without any way using first derivative of G vanishes. But also demonstrate to you that del by del XK of this quantity vanishes. And that came about because this quantity was anti-symmetric between A and K. No way have we used in that demonstration the vanishing of first derivatives. Yes.
There is no other. There is nothing to do with the first.
First derivative. Yes. In the in the definition, it's just the definition by any metric. And the two properties that we prove, that A defines a symmetric stress tensor, B defines a conserved, not covariantly conserved, conserved stress tensor. You know, you may not like the word stress tensor, but it defines a symmetric quantity and it defines a conserved quantity. That we prove just directly without using making any assumptions. Okay. Now, this was mathematics. Okay, mathematics can't tell you what energy is in the system. Okay, you have to put in some physics. And where you put in the physics is this. That we've shown that this definition reduces to the matter stress tensor in a frame where the first derivatives of G vanish. This is an exact accord with what you would expect for the actual stress tensor in general relativity from the equivalence principle. Because in a frame where the first derivatives of G vanish, just in that local frame, there are quote-unquote no gravitational waves. Yeah, these equivalence principles, like with the flat space, purpose of first derivatives. Right. Okay? So, in that frame, this should reduce to the matter stress tensor. Now, the fact that you can't, over all of space-time, choose such a frame, that is your question, means that you cannot, this will not, it will not be possible to everywhere regard this as matter stress tensor. Okay? So this is a definition. It's a definition of the full stress energy tensor in general relativity that agrees with the matter stress tensor in special frames, but in general, is more general.
This minus the matter stress energy tensor tells you something about the energy.
Very good. Okay. Now this algebra I'm going to work out, but the algebra that Pratyush was asking about has been worked out in Landau Lipschitz. That I'm not going to work out. But I'm just going to... Now that you have this quantum, you have a definition. You can just compute T full ij minus T matter ij. For T matter ij, you use the Einstein equations. So, after constants, you replace it by R I K minus half R G I K and the right coefficients. Right. This is some expression that is made out entirely of the metric field. Because T full is made out of the metric field. And this quantity is made out of the metric field. Okay? Moreover, it's some quantity that vanishes. This quantity, some quantity we know that vanishes when all first derivatives of the metric vanish. Okay? Lastly, it is a quantity that is obviously a two-derivative expression. Because T full has two derivatives, because in H there is a derivative, and in T is another derivative. Also R has two derivatives. So this quantity is going to be some quantity that consists of two derivative expressions of the metric tensor. Okay? And that vanishes when the first derivative of the metric vanishes. That tells you that it cannot have a term that is second derivative of the metric. Because if it had a term that was second derivative of the metric, in order for it to vanish, when the first derivative has vanished, you would have to multiply it by another derivative of the metric. But that's three derivative, not two derivative. So the only possibility is it's a quadratic form in first derivatives of the metric. But we know that first derivatives of the metric can be written in terms of Christoffel's laws. So we can regard it as a quadratic form, a quadratic expression in Christoffel's laws. Okay? Now, one can actually just work this out. And I'm not even going to actually write it out. I didn't even try to work this out because Landau should say, after a rather lengthy calculation, we know. When they say after a trivial calculation, I swear. Okay, you get some expression that is quadratic in the double symbols. It's an equation 96.8 of Landau equations. We will never need that expression. Okay, Landau equations make a big deal of it for me, I think. But the important thing is some quadratic expression in terms of response. As you will see, we don't need that expression. But you can work it out. This is the thing that you might want to associate. This is the thing that you might want to call, as Pratyush suggested, the stress energy tensor of the gravitational wave. Because the full stress tensor should be thought of as the stress tensor of matter plus the stress tensor of gravity. However, I emphasize again and again and again that this is a bit fake. Because Christoffel symbols are not tensors. You can be in a frame where that gravitational stress tensor is zero. Just by making a change of coordinates, you can make it non-zero. Again, the basic beautiful property of real tensors is that if they're zero in one frame, they're zero in every other, because their transformation laws are linear. This is a pseudo-tensor. Okay, it has inhomogeneous terms in its transformation because Christoffel symbols have inhomogeneous terms in their transformations. Okay? So, at the moment you might think, well, we've done a lot of work and we haven't done anything too interesting. We've defined some gravitational stress tensor, total stress tensor, but it seems a bit ambiguous. And why should anyone care about it? No, I think it's just quite a change. Quite a change. You know, this will be equal to the stress tensor arbitrarily coupled. That's T4 minus T, T matter, whatever that matter is. And it conformally coupled. That doesn't matter. Please.
What motivates the choice of that
definition? The thing that motivates the choice of this definition is the way we approached it was to ask. Okay, I think you've been out there, let me just repeat this. The way we started this class, the serious part of this class, the way we started this class was by asking, look, Einstein's equations, when you use Einstein's equations, the covariant conservation of the stress tensor is an identity. Okay? Because it's some identity for the metric, for the Ricci tensor. Okay? Now, in a frame in which the first derivatives of the metric vanish, the covariant conservation of the Ricci minus Gij by 2 R becomes must be an identity which reflects the ordinary conservation, that quantity in that special frame must be identically ordinarily conserved. Then we ask, now, how do you get a quantity that is just identically conserved? There's two derivatives, there are two indices, and it's identically conserved. And one clever way of getting that is that if this quantity is del by del xa of hrk a, where you have antisymmetry between k and a, then the conservation of this thing will be automatic. So that's one way in which such an identity could work. Okay, so we looked for such a quantity and found it. That quantity was this. So it was this, defined in terms of that. Okay, so that's how we came upon that definition.
This happens to be such a
quantity. Well, yes, I haven't done the algebra that shows you that. This is what I will do at some point, unless we run to the faster than I do this. Yes.
Yeah. Formula for lambda looks somewhat like that epsilon delta identity. In fact, if you take two g's outside, and then it becomes delta into delta minus delta into delta.
Yes.
So that can be put as product of two epsilons. So is that the indication of where this formula comes from?
Okay, good point. There may be a way of thinking of it, but I don't know. You're saying that it sounds like it's coming out of forms, coming out of existential objects. Very likely there's something in what you say, but I don't know.
So,
yes.
So what do you mean by energy of that thing? It's like, in the way when we talk of matter, we are talking about space-time translation and the symmetry of that giving us that.
Yeah.
And if you do, like, if you just take the gravity action and then vary the gene, that is the term we get the second part of the term. Yeah.
What we're going to mean is, you see, whenever you define a new theory, you want to define some concept in the new theory, it should satisfy two criteria. The first criterion is that it should satisfy all the properties you want to. In this case, it should satisfy conservation. The second criterion is that it should reduce to your old definition of energy and moment. When you reduce to the special limit, that's a Newtonian theory. Okay? So these are the two properties we will demand of this one. That in the Newtonian limit, it reduces to our usual action of kinetic plus potential. Clearly, in the Newtonian limit, there's gravitational energy. That's minus gmm by r energy. It should reduce to that in the appropriate limit. But more generally than the Newtonian limit, it should be conserved. Any quantity that satisfies these criteria, if you have a quantity that satisfies this criteria, it's a good candidate to call energy. Is this clear?
There's no independent way of defining just the field energy. We don't have a matter.
Through Noether's charges. You see, Noether's charges are a bit tricky here because you want to use time translation invariance or something. But an arbitrary coordinate system does not have time translation.
Your axis is invariant
and diffeomorphism. Action is invariant and diffeomorphisms, that's true. But there are an infinite number of diffeomorphisms.
But parameterized.
But they're parameterized by functions.
Infinite.
Even so, infinite number of them. You see, how many symmetries do we need for energy momentum? We need a form. Translation in time, translation in space. Okay. How many symmetries do you have in diffeomorphisms? An infinite number. Because arbitrary functional redefinitions of x, even infinite. Arbitrary functional redefinitions of t. Okay? So what you're saying, okay. Now, however, you're on the right track. Okay. There is an evolved theory for people to do these things formally of how to define energy momentum tensors in general in various interesting general relativistic contexts. Okay. And this theory basically does the following. You see, okay, let me just say, because you're asking, we won't go through that yet. What? You see, you know, even the Hamiltonian formalism. Yeah, okay. The Hamiltonian formalism would work if you did it correctly. But it's difficult because you want to somehow respect general covariance. Okay, but just let me get back to your Pratyusha's question. Let me say the following. You see, there are, in any theory, in any gauge theory, okay, there are two kinds of gauge transformations. Those that vanish at infinity. And those that do not. Okay? It's a general principle of gauge theories that diffeomorphisms that do not vanish at infinity define gauge transformations that do not vanish at infinity. In our context, the gauge transformations are diffeomorphisms, are associated with global conserved charges. Okay, whereas the gauge transformations that do vanish fast enough at infinity are not. Okay, now in there's a very you see there's a the way that this is processed is following. To define your dynamical system, you put some boundary conditions. These boundary conditions are typically that the metric tau fast enough at infinity. Then you look at all diffeomorphisms that are consistent with those boundary conditions. But don't die off so fast, and you have to define how what that means, that they don't give you a conserved charge. Okay? And thinking this problem through, you would get energy momentum. The way we're talking about, but it's a very involved, you know, technical analysis. This problem, by the way, is very this way of thinking of it can be very useful, because what I'm going to talk about is gravitational stress, stress energy, energy momentum in flat space. You know, if you will, asymptotically empty the sitter space, that's it. The sitter space, you might want to define the same thing, and that won't work. So you might want some general principle that will generalize many different backgrounds. And there are many, this is a matter of, you know, much research in the gravitational community. There are 20 different ways of thinking of how to define stress tensors. Okay? And, the point is that in reasonable contexts, they all give the same answers. Yeah. So there is a way of thinking, but it's very technical.
So does this really have, like, in some sense, fixing the background?
Very good. Okay, let me just make a point. So the question leads me to the main point. You see, so far, all that I have told you about is leading you to dissatisfaction. Because I've defined a quantity, but I've said that it doesn't really seem to be very physical. But now let me take this quantity and integrate it over a space like space. Okay, now, suppose I take this quantity and I integrate it over a space like slice. And I assume that at infinity on the space like slice, my space is flat. This is the assumption I'm going to make. Okay? What that means, I'm going to explain a little more, that the metric is flat space plus some small deviations. I'll explain that. But you can already guess, right? Because you know from the Schwarzschild metric deviates from the ordinary metric like 1 by r. That's the flat. So that's the condition under it. That all deviations from flat space at infinity are of order 1 by r. Suppose I make this assumption. Okay. Then, A, the quantity that I defined, which was this pseudo tensor locally. Okay, now, in this case, there is a distinguished set of coordinates at infinity. Not in the whole space, but at infinity. Namely, the Minkowskian coordinates at infinity. The space-time at infinity is flat. Okay? So, I've got a space-time that at infinity is approximately flat. Like, I'll make that precise. But it's basically almost flat. So, there's a distinguished set of coordinates at infinity. Now, demanding that you're working in these coordinates doesn't completely fix your coordinates. Because what transformations of flat coordinates did you in flat coordinates?
Lorentz
transformations, exactly. So it fixes these coordinates up to Lorentz transformations. But Lorentz transformations are linear deformations. And these Christoffel symbols, which do not transform as tensors under arbitrary deformations, do transform as tensors under linear deformations. Because the inhomogeneous part is associated with the second derivative of the coordinate change. So the quantity that we're going to get by, okay, so it's clear then from what I've been saying that in order to start getting something nice, we somehow have to refer to infinity. Okay? And infinity is something nice. There's a particular nice coordinate system we can hold on to. Not quite a particular nice coordinate system, but a class of coordinate systems related by Lorentz forces.
So our infinity means that everywhere it should be this.
In every direction it should go flat. Okay. Okay. Now, the next thing about this is that this. Okay. So now suppose I take this quantity, this conserved stress tensor, and I just do the ordinary integral of it. Okay, I do dik dsk. Well, this dsk is just the geometric volume element. It makes no reference to the metric. Because t is an ordinarily conserved quantity. Okay? So, I take this quantity and I integrate it over all space. This quantity is guaranteed to be conserved by the usual Gauss law arguments.
Is the volume element contains the determinant of the metric?
The volume element contains the determinant of the metric. But you see, what we have here is a quantity that, okay, sorry, I shouldn't have said it. More accurately, this P by P X A H I K. You see, what I'm interested in doing is defining something that is conserved. Since this derivative makes no mention of the net, if I want to get something conserved, I have to use just the ordinary Gauss law of coordinate transfer, just ordinary Gauss law of integration. Do you understand what I mean? Gauss's law, Gauss's theorem is a theorem about integrals. You understand what I mean? Okay? Gauss's theorem is a theorem about integrals. It tells you that if you've got a total derivative, then you can relate it. You can relate the integral of that total derivative over a slice to the integral of some surface something. Okay? Just as an identity on integrals. Okay? So I want to use that identity on integrals to get something conserved. So, hang on one second, let me just finish this. So,
yeah, we have, in 4 minutes we're going to have to go for the first enlightening tree.
Okay, but let me, okay, I won't be able to do the algebra, but at least I'll make the main point. Just hang on. So, now this quantity, by the usual Gauss law argument, gives you some, firstly, how many indices does it have? A is not tractable, K is not tractable, I is. So it's a foreign net object. For each value of I, by the usual Gauss law argument, it is a conserved quantity. Okay? And just reminding ourselves, what is the usual Gauss law argument? The usual Gauss law argument tells you that if nothing funny is happening at infinity, which is what we're assuming, then the integral, the surface integral of this quantity is equal to the volume integral. But we're assuming that the surface is an infinity to a contribute. So this surface integral minus this surface integral, meaning this minus this, is equal to the volume integral of the divergence. But the divergence vanishes. So this surface integral is equal to this surface integral. This is true, Arshan, for arbitrary space-like slices.
Just one.
Yes.
By the fact that you do this volume integral,
yes,
instead of the, I mean, including the G,
yes,
which is the code space volume,
yes,
it means that you've sort of changed your background.
Same, changed your what?
Changed your background on which you're integrating the stress energy tensor, namely del X, A.
Maybe you can interpret it this way. But just think about algebra. I want to define a quantity that will be conserved. This quantity will be conserved. Okay? Now, you might think it's really unnatural to do some sort of surface integral without the volume factor, but remember that it's only at infinity that this thing will have meaning. Okay? And at infinity, your space-time reduces to flat. So there's no difference between the ordinary integral there and the flat integral. Okay? But here you're just doing the ordinary integral because you want to conserve quantity. We're not going to allow any. You see, it's dangerous to use your biases because we're not dealing with tensors.
Yeah, but I was saying this quantity del x h I k can't be interpreted as a density in curved space on which it is defined.
I mean, modulo all the problems of it not being a tensor.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, so we're not going to give too serious interpretation to the local contributions to the index. What we're going to seriously look at is the final answer after integration. Is this clear? Okay. Now, from the fact that gammas transform as pseudo-tensors, that is, tensors under linear diffeomorphisms, it follows that this quantity transforms like a four-vector under Lorentz transformations. Okay. So, 4-vector. Just because
gammas transform under as four vectors under Lorentz transformations at infinity, and the indices are contracted out. Okay. Now it would be totally clear if you looked at lambda of Lipschitz difficult to derive expression. Okay? So that's another positive hit. You know, when we're looking at something that reduces to flat space far away, for somebody who's interested in just an overall conserved quantity, you might think you shouldn't have to care whether things are curved deep inside or not. Outside, you've got an anchor of flat space. So things should transform like under, you know, good representations of Lorentz transformations in that anchor flat space. This quantity is doing it. Now, the next question is, are we going to get the same answer? Are we going to get the same answer? So, if we use different coordinate systems, because in order to do this integral, I've said you have to use some coordinate system that goes to the flat space coordinate at infinity. But I'm telling you what is inside. Okay? And there are many different coordinate systems that go to the flat space. But they differ by diffeomorphisms of the first kind, the kinds that don't cause quantum charges. The ones that die off. Okay? And the answer is, of manifestly yes. Okay? And let me give you the answer. This is the argument.
Tells you that the conserved value in the first coordinate system
is equal to the conserved value of the same. It's a tricky sounding argument. Be sure you would believe it. You buy it. It's totally correct. It's a kind of argument Landau, you know. Anyway, it's the kind of argument that someone like Landau uses. Brilliant. Is this totally clear?
So, when you have the infinite idea, in the limit that space goes to infinity, it's flat.
Yes.
But these two slices, which yes. represent the same space-time, are infinity, can they be related by a
logarithm? No. What I'm going to assume is where you will. What I want to prove is that two coordinate systems that are identical at infinity, but differ inside, give you the same energy. If you take two coordinate systems that are not identical at infinity, then what you'll get is the energy momentum won't be the same. We've already seen that. They differ in Lorentz transformations. So the two things I want to check. Firstly, two coordinate systems that are identical at infinity, but differ inside, give you the same value. Secondly, now if you take some coordinate transformation that does whatever you want inside, but at infinity reduces to a linear coordinate transformation, that transforms like a form. Both these we prove. We prove because every expression of T-Fullan is made up of pseudo tensors.
Can
there
be a metric
finite space-time where the sensible components are identical? What's it? Of course they can. So you could.
This closed.
Yes, the universe is probably such a place. This is a space. Then you're going to have to think hard about how to define energy in that space. But of course, you know, for practical purposes in our universe, suppose we want to define the energy of the Earth Sun system. We don't need to. We can take infinity to be far away from the Sun. So for practical purposes, it's useful anyway. You know, to the extent that you can approximate space time as well, this is useful. But for some absolute statements, in principle statements, different space-time asymptotes give totally different answers. For instance, in De Sitter space, it's very problematic to define stress energy momentum, as we may discuss as well. But 90% space is very essential. Well, because global De Sitter space is a compact. Space-like slices of global De Sitter space are compact. Yeah, why is that a problem? That's actually its compact. Hey, I organized that neutrino talks. Okay, so we talk about it.